I would like to welcome everybody to our annual Morehouse Bates public debate. And the reason we have this debate every year is to give nod to the historical connections between our two colleges. As many of you probably know, one of the most illustrious alums of Bates College is Benjamin Mays, who was obviously an important person being a longtime mentor of Martin Luther King Jr. He was also the longtime president of Morehouse College, and while he was at Bates College, he was a member of the Brooks Quimby Debate Council. He found that debate was an important part of his life that helped him shape things as he went forward. He is famously quoted as saying that debate did not empower him, but debate gave him the skills he needed to empower himself. And that is what we hope to achieve with our debate programs, both at Bates and at Morehouse. So we have the debate so that we can have a discussion of issues. Aristotle said rhetoric is important because it teaches you to understand positions from, well, he says from both sides, but as we all know, there's usually a multiplicity of sides to any issue and not just two. But the educational value of debate and why part of the reason we hold this debate on Martin Luther King Day as part of the learning experience that we have at our college is that debate allows us to understand issues from a variety of perspectives, to be things brought to our attention that we may not have thought of prior to that, and to really think through issues when things are placed in an agonistic relationship to each other and see how they relate to each other and stack up against each other. I would like to remind you all that the debaters did not choose the topic, the debaters did not necessarily choose the position that they were going to be in, and they may make arguments that they do not personally believe in. Not everything that they say is a deeply held belief that they had. Some of it might be, but a chunk of it probably will not be. Debate is one of those activities that requires people to push themselves by learning positions that they don't believe in, that they don't agree in. The fundamental precept behind that is you don't really understand an issue or the opposition to your own position unless you understand the opposition arguments as well. And so we hope that you will take it in the spirit in which this debate is intended. Before we move on, I would like to give a quick shout out to Aaron Dicker, who is the Assistant Director of Debate at Morehouse College and currently a PhD candidate at Georgia State University. I would now like to turn the podium over to Bennett Saltzman, who is our convener of public debates. He will explain the debate format to you, introduce the debaters, and the motion as well.
So to echo Jen, it's truly an honor on behalf of the BQDC to have all of you here and on the live stream as well. I have a pretty simple job. I'm going to tell you how the speeches are going to go, and then I'll give the debaters a proper introduction before letting the round commence. So today we're going to be discussing the motion that states, this House believes the state should exclusively focus on rectifying current inequalities to the exclusion of compensating for historical injustices. This side is our government team in today's round. They will be defending rectifying current inequalities, and opposition will be defending compensating for historical injustices. Both teams will give some clarity to what exactly this means in the context of their speeches. So, the debate. We're going to have Tessa Holtzman speaking first. Tessa is from Las Cruces, New Mexico. She is a senior at Bates College, a politics major. She's been a top 10 speaker at Brandeis, broken at Wesleyan twice. She was the second team at the Pan-African Debate Championships. She is the president of our debate society, and she started the first high school debate team in Bolivia. She'll be giving the first speech and also the rebuttal speech for the proposition team. Speaking second, we have Mati Baker, who's a junior from Baltimore, Maryland at Morehouse. He's an African-American studies major and a religion minor. He's won the Jamaican Association for Debating and Empowerment Championship, winner of the Borea debating tournament, and he has two Yorkies named Boss and Drama. Following him, we're going to hear a speech from Proposition again. Sha'Heed Brooks is from Fayetteville, North Carolina. He's a philosophy major at Morehouse. He represented Morehouse recently at the World's Universities Debating Championship in the Netherlands. As a fun fact, his parents have conflicting stories about how he was named, and he was born on Friday the 13th. Finally, speaking for opposition in the constructive speeches, we have Zoe Seaman-Grant. She's from Charleston, South Carolina, and a women and gender studies major at Bates College. Recently, despite Well, recently she's finaled and won a number of things, but recently she was the Yale IV top speaker, and she was the first World University Debating Championship finalist to ever come from the Bates College debating team or Bates College. And while studying abroad in Australia, she cried when meeting a kangaroo. So after those four constructive speeches, I'm going to come back up on the stage and open up to some audience question and answers. We'll have two people with mics going around, and at that point, we'd love to garner some insight from everybody about if they have additional thoughts, if they have things that they want the debaters to consider. After that, we will have two rebuttal speeches. As I mentioned before, Tessa will be giving one, and then we'll also have one from the opposition team. And what, at this point in time, the debaters will consider some of the ideas brought up throughout the entire round and by you, the audience, and will sum up what both sides truly believe in. I think we have an excellent debate on our hands, and I'm really excited to watch. Tessa, you have the floor.
Though slavery was officially ended by the 13th Amendment in 1863, the enslavement of the African American community did not stop there. Currently, the criminal justice system imprisons millions of African Americans annually because of racist sentencing laws and racist judicial practices. While imprisoned, these African Americans are subjected to labor, to inservitude and labor. But further, we tell you that between 2015 and 2016, law enforcement officials killed 635 members of the African American community. Education funding continually disadvantaged public schools in minority communities, and inner city communities were over and over again subjected and currently suffer from state-sanctioned racism. It is just simply a fact that slavery has not in fact ended, and that these communities suffer from inequalities and injustices every day. We on side government today question the effectiveness of reparations and the ability of reparations to act as a necessary tool to actually solve for these current inequalities, because we think the most important thing that we can be doing as a community today is working together to solve for these inequalities, making sure that they do not continue to happen. I will be promoting two arguments in this speech. First, on the obligation of the government to protect the well-being of current citizens and to act as a utilitarian actor. And second, on why we think targeted social programs create better outcomes for those suffering from current injustices. But to begin with, a few quick definitions to clarify the debate we are talking about today. Though I couched the debate in my introduction as just about the African American community, we think it's important to recognize that there are lots of current communities who are continually disadvantaged by inequality, including women, Native Americans, and immigrant communities within the United States. When we are talking about focusing exclusively on rectifying current inequalities, we are talking about using targeted programs and government spending to solve for them. Examples of this would include prison reforms, sentencing reforms, police retraining programs, a redistribution of education funding, policies to combat the segregation that currently happens in public schools by busing students to other school districts, and making sure that people can continue to afford to live in communities that are harmed and by gentrification. We think that targeted programs are opposed to the reparations that side opposition is defending in today's debate, reparations being program or payments directly made to those who suffer from unjust historical government action. The first argument that I'm making today is on the obligation of the government. We would put forth to you, as side government, that the government is not an actor that ought be morally driven, but instead that one that ought be driven by utilitarian needs. That is to say that the government should not be based on morals and moral claims, which is what reparations are inherently, but instead outcomes. We're to tell you that we are able to get better outcomes on the government side because we are able to look specifically at what these communities need and then work to solve for those inequalities that these communities are facing. So secondly, we'd like to tell you three specific ways that we, on our side of the house as the government, are able to create better outcomes. First, we would question the ability of reparations to adequately solve for past and present inequalities. So recognize that we do not know who necessarily suffered or at the hands of who they suffered for from those actions in the past, which we think makes it pragmatically difficult to actually have the outcomes and the reparations that they are advocating for. But more importantly, recognize that reparations also don't recognize the diversity of disadvantaged communities. So these communities ought not be seen as a monolithic group that has the exact same needs or suffered the exact same amount based on past injustices committed against them. We think that we are better able to serve these groups, recognizing that there are a diversity of needs and a diversity of interests that might depend based on geographic location or specific interests or identities that they identify with. We tell you that you are able to make sure that people are helped more effectively, which is going to lead to solutions in the long run when you are able to use things like on-the-ground analysis and data to say the inner city of Chicago needs different policies than, for example, those who are living in Alabama. We think that this is what's actually important and what is going to lead to long-term outcomes. But secondly, we tell you that we don't think that inequality is decided on the basis of access to capital. So the underlying assumption of the side opposition team in today's debate is that by giving people reparations or lump sums of cash, that is going to solve for the inequalities that they face. We tell you this is not actually the case, and we don't think that it's true that capital is what is going to be the tipping point to solve for these inequalities in the future. We tell you that the fear of, for example, being pulled over every time that you get in your car because of racist profiling isn't going to be solved by having more money in your pocket. Instead, it is going to be solved by pragmatic programs like, for example, police retraining.
Sure. If you think there needs to be a diversity of policies to address the different needs of different people, wouldn't it be better to give people lump sums of money so that they could choose how to spend that money instead of having a federal government institute blanket policies on communities?
The problem with this, and this will be talked about more by my member of government, is that it changes the way that people view these communities perceptually. So it may be the case that they have money and they can choose to spend it how they want, but if perceptually the public sees this as being handouts that are given to them based on unconditionality, then we think that it is less likely that these people and these communities are going to be able to use this in an effective manner. The final thing that we want to talk about, and the final reason why we think that we create better outcomes on our side of the house, is that we think that there is a current problem and a current inability of the public to come to terms with the fact that there are inequalities that are happening today in front of our very eyes. We think that targeted programming promotes a public understanding of this discourse in a way that reparations cannot, because we can point out data and use data to back up the reasons why we're using this targeted programming. We think that this means that the public is going to be more invested and more interested in the work that we are doing, which we tell you is also an important step in making sure to create the types of outcomes that we want to have. On our side of the house, we tell you that we are able to give you a path to solvency in the long term. On their side of the house, they are just doing a one-time lump sum of cash, which we think doesn't adequately address for the current inequalities, while also not adequately addressing the inequalities of the past, which continue to impact the future.
First, as is our custom, I'd like to extend a round of thank yous to everyone in the room. Everyone here at Bates who was with us when we arrived, greeted us, joined us in the CAF, things like that. We appreciate you. Everyone here at Bates that was instrumental in us coming, thank you so much. Give yourselves a round of applause. This debate, ladies and gentlemen, must take place at a broader, more accurate context. a context that reveals how since the first African Americans landed here in 1526, there has been a system that has economically profited on the backs of slaves, to which it did nothing but prevent these persons from gaining profit and from gaining prosperity themselves. A context that speaks about how since the Constitutional Convention offered the compromise of three-fifths, there is a structural put in place idea that African Americans are somehow inferior, that rendered some individuals not able to economically prosper because some jobs we just simply don't feel qualified for. That mentality we stand against on side opposition. We also want a context here that displays how the United States government has also done a very, very good job at making sure that it structures laws in a way that protect the privileged and marginalized minorities. When is this the case? We see this before in how voter suppression laws thrived throughout the 1960s, and we also see this today. It's important that we talk about these things because these are the things that remove the agency of African Americans to gain prosperity economically and to benefit their own communities. This debate takes place in this context. We're here to address a debt. Slavery drove the Southern economy. White owners of slaves were able to profit off of their free labor, sell the products to states like Maine, where these things were milled into things that were also sold, where everyone was able to profit off of the backs of the free labor. We say that there's a debt there. Money and wealth enabled these individuals to sometimes become president, enabled these individuals to have lives of power, to have their hands on the levers of power, and to deny the levers of power to African Americans. We say that that is principally bad. On these bases, we support reparations. We say that today, we think that these persons that were once working for free, the ancestors that that we have today as African Americans, have paid a price by which they have not been paid for it. We certainly seek today to get that what is owed. Sai government wants you to believe in more of the same. They want you to believe in reform after reform after reform. They're basically saying to you this, audience: hey, African Americans, we understand that you all are disenfranchised. We understand that you all need resources. So we're going to fund different things. We're going to give you money, but we're going to spend it on the best way that we see fit. We see principally on side government that we support the principle that if something is stolen, it should be given back. If there is a population by which you are taking money, taking resources, taking a person's ability to prosper economically, those things should be given back irrespective of what those persons do with those things. This is the principle that we stand for on our side of the house. Few things that we believe come from this. We think that on our side of the house, you get a better emboldening of the spending power of African Americans, which you do not get over there. Six things happen here. Firstly, we think that it is important to represent the principle here that African Americans have had something, had money, had economic prosperity taken from them, and that we deserve to get that back. That principle we stand for here. Secondly, we think that this enables people to invest into their own communities. African Americans who do not usually get investments by the state will be able to invest and will be able to build their own institutions instead of relying on the state that has failed them in the past as what you get on side government. We prefer those two things here in this debate. But also, we think, thirdly, that African Americans will now be able to build their own businesses. We think that this is certainly important in a world where small businesses need to thrive and where African Americans need to have their hands on the levers of power by being able to have economic prosperity in terms of their ability to own their own businesses. Fourthly, we think that African Americans will benefit by having to work less hours. Generally, African Americans There have been advancements made in terms of hiring practices, but there are still racist individuals that preside over the hiring practices of many of these companies that offer opportunities. We think that we prefer a world where African Americans have the ability, I'll get you at the bottom of this, to create their own businesses and to do these things and spend in their own community. Fifthly, more importantly, we believe that it is important to mobilize the African American community, give them the resources so that they can be political powers. The reason that the Koch brothers are able to advance their ideologies is because they have the money to do so. We think that on our side of the house, it is extremely important to adopt a mentality and ideology that which African Americans are able to become economic powers, spend on their own campaigns, and fund their own candidates. Yes.
You talk about being able to work less hours, but how are you going to be able to work at all if reparations do nothing to combat, for example, racist hiring practices, where if you have a name that is associated with being African American, you won't even ever be considered equally to a white candidate?
Okay, two things. First, I don't think that side government does anything to change this on their side of the house. Those that are racist in hiring practices, a law is not going to change that. Secondly, what we think on our side of the house is that we prefer a world where black people are able to create their own businesses. I don't think that you should promote an ideology that says we're going to make it easier so that black people can apply to business that are not their own. I think that this is certainly part of the problem, and this is certainly something that we need to fix. But moving on, more importantly, on-site government, we heard two things. Here are the most important arguments that come out on their side of the house, and Tessa will go forth and finish, and Zoe will go forth and finish what I'm talking about here. First thing, they said that the obligation of the state should be to support policies that are utilitarian. This is the principle that says, literally, we are going to support the benefit of the many at the least detriment of the few. Why is this problematic? Because this is the same ideology that has enabled the majority to continue to promote policies that maintain white privilege. Under a go ahead. Under a utilitarian framework, we will not get a minority voice, Sha'Heed. Under a utilitarian framework, we will not get the voice that you get on our side of the house. That's part of the problem. We prefer a government that is moral. If we have had a government that is moral, we possibly would not have the years of Jim Crow and segregation that we are here talking about today. And we certainly think that that's problematic, and we're the only side of this debate that changes that. But secondly, the argument that we hear from them is that there's an inability of the public, they promote the public's understanding. They are able to use data and things like that. They're able to use statistics and things like that to better help these communities. Here's the problem with this. We already have statistics. We already have data. We already have access to all of the things that they are trying to create and say that they're going to create through these programs on their side of the house. What we do not have is what you get here, where we talk about what we get here. What we get is a world in which America pays back what it owes to a people, a cost at which persons have paid, and it continues to deny these persons the money at which it deserves. We think on our side of the house, reparations are key to the change that we're talking about here. On their side of the house, you get more of the same. So proud to propose.
Ladies and gentlemen, history is not simply about the past. Rather, it exists on a continuum, subsuming and absorbing every passing moment into its canon. That is why focusing on past historical injustices to the exclusion of present inequalities only perpetuates a cycle of tragedy, oppression, and marginalization. Why? Because the current inequalities of today, if unaddressed, become the past historical injustices of tomorrow. And that is what side opposition needs to deal with. So, three things in this speech. First, I'm going to provide you analysis on how reparations shifts the perception of oppressed communities in a way that is harmful. Second, I'm going to talk to you about better outcomes. And third, about how reparations are inadequate. So, first, on responses to the leader of opposition. What do we hear out of his speech? I think it's important to note, first of all, just how generally unresponsive he was to Tessa's case. He gives two points of analysis at the very end of his speech, but they don't deal with the crux of Tessa's analysis. So, what does he tell us? He tells us that there is a principle at the fundamental heart of this case. We agree. He says that it's about paying individuals what they are owed. We agree. But what he does not single out for us is why reparations is the unique form that this compensation must take. What we tell you is that the best way to address historical injustices is to provide a way for the generations and descendants of those who have been affected by those historical injustices to have prosperity that their ancestors were not given to. That is the reason why we want targeted programs, laws, and policies that focus on the current inequalities that are, in effect, the outcome and the consequences of historical injustices that they want to talk about. Second, he tells us that they are able, African American communities now with reparations, to invest within their own communities. I think that this is largely a presumption that they cannot have guaranteed on their side of the house. Why is this the case? Because what they do on their side of the house is they give African American communities a one-time payment. This then rests on the ability and the will of African American communities to invest within their own communities. Why do we think that it is largely unlikely that they will be able to use this money in ways that invest within their own communities and are able to start businesses? Because what they fail to realize is that currently there are inequalities in terms of employment. There are staggering loads of debt incurred by student debt, or rather that is healthcare debt, that these individuals have to deal with. There are pressing real life concerns that are tangible right now that these communities will have to use this money to pay for. Unless you're giving these individuals millions of dollars, which I think is highly unlikely, it is unlikely that they will be able to have the economic capital within a system that still excludes them from business opportunities, from loans, from the ability to actually have property development in a way that is good. That is only solved on our side of the house when we have targeted programs that fix the structural issues that keep African Americans from accessing capital. Third, he tells you economic prosperity, invest in their businesses. I just dealt with that. Fourth and fifth, he talks about they can work less hours. We don't see how this is necessary. They will still have to have jobs. It is unclear to us the link between them getting this money and them having to work less hours. But the fifth important point to note on their case, he never quite got to the sixth, is about political capital. He says that this will allow for them to engender political capital, and then he compares it to the Koch brothers. I think the Koch brothers, who are billionaires, will still have way more political capital than any one African American can actually acquire. Also, even if we assume that they are to band together to have one cohesive community, invest in communities as a whole, we think that still largely plays and depends on the will of these African American communities. And given the current inequalities that they face and the real life pressing concerns that they have to deal with that this money will likely be directed to, it is unlikely to see them investing in large scale programs and the political capital, especially within a system that on their side of the house they don't fix. So we still have systemic ways to oppress these communities no matter how much political capital they are in fact able to gain. And we would also question the need for reparations to be the sole solution to for political capital for African Americans, especially in a time we have seen more African American mayors, more African American legislators, we have seen more African American leaders with rising up within our nation. We don't think that reparations uniquely allows for them to solve. So I'll take you in a few seconds. So first, on our first argument today, how reparations shift the perception of oppressed communities in a way that is harmful. Three things to note on this. First, people often feel disconnected from the past. This means that individuals on their side of the house, who they would want to actually help to deal with this compensation, are largely disconnected from those historical injustices. What does this mean? This means that there's a lack of empathy by certain individuals and allies that we would need to have the political will to solve structural and systemic problems that currently face African Americans. Second, it shifts the perception of accountability from the state to minority communities. Their entire case rests on the presumption that now minority communities will be more independent and they will be able to invest within their communities. The problem with this is that they even note that this is a long-term deal we're talking about. Systemic inequalities took centuries to entrench within our communities, and it will certainly not be solved by a one-time check. What is important to understand is that now the state feels as though it is not no longer has to be accountable to its citizens. Now it shifts all of the burden to the minority communities. What I think is more important to note is that, and I'll take you literally right now, Zoe, is that it's very hard and it's very difficult, and I'll leave you with this, to quantify the harms that African Americans have to deal with. In order to give reparations, you would have to quantify all of the harms that they have faced throughout centuries, which we don't think, one, will ever adequately measure up to the resources that the state can provide for long-term systemic change. Yes, Zoe, I'll take you.
So we already have laws banning employment discrimination. We have laws banning discrimination when you give loans to Black Americans, and yet those individuals are consistently denied access to those things and don't have the money to sue those corporations when they deny them access. How do you change that? By just reinstituting the policies we've already instituted and already seen fail.
I think the problem with her case and the assumption that she makes is that we have actually listed all of the innovative and proper ways of policy to ensure that these things are not instituted correctly. We think that the problem with that question is that the policies have been instituted, but they have been instituted in ways that largely do not help the African American community. What we will want to change on our side of the house is to provide new programs, to look at the on-the-ground analysis and the data, and to find new and innovative ways to institute programs and policies. But even when it comes to loans or it comes to economic prosperity, their side of the house never deals with mass incarceration, their side of the house never deals with police brutality in a way that we can only get when we focus on the current inequalities that individuals face. Make no mistake in this debate, it is not simply about the past or the present, but it is also about the future. Thank you.
This debate isn't just about putting a few more Head Start programs for kindergartners. It's about how we give autonomy back to a community that has been denied it for centuries. The way they have been denied it is the ways Tessa started her speech with. It's through enslavement, it's through prisons, it's through the denial of capital access to Black Americans when they returned from World War II and were not given access to the equal things that were given to white veterans. The way we fix this is not by obscuring those past injustices, but rather acknowledging them, confronting them, and then giving the capital that was stolen back. We don't care how these communities use that capital. We think they have a right to it because they have been so consistently denied freedom. We need to do this now, and we need to do it at the millions of dollars that Sha'Heed tells us we would never do. We're fine doing that because it's probably a lot more than the amount that was stolen in the first, or a lot less than the amount that was stolen in the first place. But additionally, what we tell you is when you look at these communities and you put in place data and you look at whether or not the public schools have failed in that area, you don't attribute it to the historical injustices, but rather you say it's the result of poor decisions made by that community. So when you address current inequality, it usually serves to obscure the very reasons those current inequalities exist, because you say that the data you've gathered isn't a result of redlining, it's not a result of a lack of busing, and it's not a result of school segregation, it's a result of Black parents not putting enough effort into their children's education, completely denying the fact that those parents can't put that energy in because they have to work three jobs because the minimum wage isn't adequate for those individuals. The thing we're telling you is that it's true that the goal of these policies is prosperity. We agree. The problem is they're trying to use all sorts of programs to get to that end goal. We just give you prosperity in the first place by putting that money back into the pockets of Black Americans, which we think is a probably more efficient way and just more reliable way of doing it than the policies we've already seen fail on the government side of the house. But I also think that by doing this and by addressing current inequalities and obscuring those past structural injustices, the U.S. federal government is able to position itself as a savior and as a benevolent actor that acts in the interests of Black Americans, which wholeheartedly flies in the face of the evidence we have. They seem to think we don't have data. Oh, we do. We have data about the way that Black Americans have been treated for centuries in this country. It's not particularly hard to find. In fact, you can open up probably any history book, and in fact, we probably should have more history books that tell us more about this, but if you saw the keynote speaker. But I think it's probably important that we do this at a much greater level. But we'd also tell you is that it's just unreasonable for them to think that reparations would somehow not work. Their whole argument is Black communities wouldn't reinvest into their own communities. But then they also tell you that the most Black mayors have been elected, the most Black politicians have been elected. If that's true, that demonstrates that Black communities are willing to support other members of their community in order to rise up and offer a counter-narrative and counter-political structures to the white hegemony that we've seen currently existing in this country. I think that's incredibly powerful because that demonstrates that Black Americans don't spend capital irrationally or don't spend it irresponsibly, but spend it on the things that matter to them, which is, for instance, getting better public schooling aid in their communities, getting better politicians who will advocate on behalf of them, or advocate on behalf of the fact that their water isn't clean and that their healthcare needs aren't met. Those are the people we care about, and we want to put the money in their hands so that they have the capital in order to actually have political power. Political power isn't just about voting. It's not just about going out to the polls. It's about actually having the money to fund the candidates you want to vote for at the polls. And at the point at which the Black community does not have that capital, they cannot do that. The other problem with the gov side and with addressing current inequalities is that lots of the programs are extremely long term. Why is that bad? By putting in new educational measures, you probably won't see the results of those new educational measures until decades down the line at the earliest. Why is that bad? Because in order to keep policies running and in order to get reapproval for those policies, you need to convince people that they're working in order to have the federal government reapprove them. The problem is it's pretty hard to demonstrate that a lot of the time because the results of those policies aren't seen for so many years. It's much easier to give a one-time payoff because it doesn't rely on constant congressional reapproval and it doesn't rely on fickle politicians who forget about your problems the minute they're not right in front of them. And then they just default to doing something that actually benefits them because they're mostly self-interested and not interested in making you better off. Yeah.
Both sides agree that these minority communities have been continually oppressed by the government. Why then should we continue to burden these communities and say that they must use their time, their money, their resources to fix these problems that the government should be recognizing?
Like, I'm not sure why it's a burden, right? Like, I think lots of people would feel enormous empowerment as a result of being able to make those choices. I don't think choice is a burden. I think choice is a massive way in which we empower communities that haven't historically had that choice. I also think that the federal government just doesn't know what's best for those communities, right? Like, that is a fallacy that has been perpetuated throughout this debate. The idea that the federal government is somehow good at allocating resources to communities or knows what those communities need. They don't. They think that they know what they need, but they don't actually talk to anyone who lives in those communities. They don't care about what's actually going on. They only care that it looks good when they present it to a few other congressmen who they need to sign off on that policy in the first place. We also tell you it's much easier, actually, to get support for rectifying historic injustices because they're much easier to demonstrate. It's extremely easy to demonstrate the ways in which there was legally sanctioned segregation. It's easy to demonstrate that slavery occurred, and it's easy to show the redlining policies that were perpetuated in this country. It's much harder to demonstrate some of the more nebulous current inequalities that exist in this country. And at the point at which you're able to demonstrate those historical injustices to a much greater extent, it becomes a lot easier to garner political support to give back reparations because people can see and easily see and understand the inequality that existed historically, whereas it's much harder to demonstrate that current inequality exists for many of the people who their side of the house needs to convince to even sign on to this policy in the first place. So I think it's better that we actually rely on those injustices that are much easier for us to contemplate. But I also think the most important thing on our side of the House is the idea that we need to situate the current inequalities in an arc of historical injustices. It is totally unreasonable for us to presume that the federal government would be good at fixing current inequalities at the point at which they refuse to acknowledge the historical injustices that led to those current inequalities. The only way that you get policies that accurately and adequately target the inequalities that exist is by acknowledging the structural reasons for them, because that's the only way you actually know where to put that money, because in any other case, you just end up giving extremely conditional welfare where you tell people they have no right to do what they want with their money because anytime they do, they choose wrong. We stand for a side that gives people autonomy and freedom that they have been denied and gives them the capital that has been stolen. We think that that is far better for progress in the United States of America. Thank you.
So at this point, we'd like to open up the mics, which will be going around shortly, to some audience questions that the debaters will then consider. And we have two more speeches remaining. They'll think about them in those speeches. So if the mics could choose one side of the room each, and if you raise your hands, we'll try and get a mic to you. So right over here, I believe, to begin.
Good afternoon. I have a question that I'm not entirely certain can be addressed within the context or the format of the debate, so I understand if you have to take polemical sides in order to address it, but I'm going to ask it anyway. The first question is, well, I have two questions actually. The first question is whether we're playing fast and loose with the term reparations. It seems as though the assumption, the base assumption on both sides of the house is that reparations equals a lump sum of cash, when in fact the definitions of reparations are a lot more expansive than that and have given us a sense of what it means to rectify inequality by shifting policies and procedures, not from necessarily a government side, but from banking and other institutions. The other question I have is one that you guys have yet to address. We've mentioned inner cities, we've mentioned marginalized communities, but we've yet to deal with the intersectionality of something like the Black middle class, which has been in existence since during the antebellum period. So what do we do with the extent to which we have quite a bit of variance within the communities that we're discussing?
Thank you. We're gonna try and alternate, so if there's a question over here, up and up top.
Thank you very much. I was wondering, since now the Black community in America is very broad and diverse in this time, you have immigrants, it's been very broad these days, so who do we give reparation to? I mean, if things were committed against slaves, I mean, how do we identify the people we give those reparations to? And then my second question is, there's a policy called the zero-sum policy. So if the government has to spend money in a certain program, they have to get that money from somewhere else. That means somebody else or another group of people have to lose money to get money, you know, to allocate for another group of people. So where are we getting that money? Who are we taking from to give to, you know, the Black community? Thank you.
So my first question was, why would we have the government pick and choose what to support when they're the problem in the first place? Like, does that make sense?
Thank you.
You guys both address issues such as mass incarceration. My question would be, how would cash directly address mass incarceration in a substantive way?
How do you make sense of the binary that you have proposed, one or the other, as opposed to both?
Thank you. Question for both sides about feasibility, I guess. So for the side that supports better programs, how would you guarantee that those programs would be more effective than what's already in place, kind of like the other side said? And for the side that supports reparations, how do you, like, that doesn't really, politically speaking right now, that doesn't seem like it's a conversation that's being had in the broader sphere. So how do you plan on making that happen, I guess?
So I'd like OpSide in particular to address the potentially problematic aspects of putting a literal price tag on the suffering that people have historically undergone. That doesn't just include capital loss, but also, in many cases, physical and emotional harm that is done upon these individuals and upon these communities. I'd like if you could address that.
There was a lot of talk, I guess, from both sides as far as like investing, African-Americans investing within their own communities. If these communities are disenfranchised and have a lack of access to education, I guess, where does the education come from to inform these communities on how to invest properly if they were to receive this money?
Okay, so as I was saying, we have two more speeches in today's round, but by no means does that mean that the conversation should end after these speeches. I'd encourage everyone to think individually, and also, if you have any remaining questions, please feel free to come down to the stage and talk to our debaters. I'm sure everyone would have more thoughts to share after the short time limit in which they're allowed to speak is finished. So, without further ado, we have two rebuttal speeches, and I thank everyone for coming out today.
The idea inherent in reparations is that the harm has been done and the harm has stopped. The harm has not stopped, and by saying that we can just give reparations, and that this thus absolves us and the government of all obligation to these people and to the injustices that they have continually perpetuated is especially harmful. And on side government, we say that this will never do anything to solve for the problems that we are currently seeing, like mass incarceration, police brutality, and social biases that continually make everyday life more difficult for minority communities. You can't get autonomy, which is what side opposition is so invested in, when you live in a society that continually suppresses you because of racist policies and biases that are never combated. A society that says, you can have your capital and you can solve these problems on your own. We aren't going to worry about it because we don't think it's that big a deal. We think that it's especially bad to put the burden on these populations to say you must use the capital that we are giving you to solve these problems that are probably the government's responsibility. The government, as a utilitarian actor, ought to have the well-being of all of its citizens in mind, and we say that this very strongly puts this obligation on the government to take action instead of trying to sidestep this obligation and say, you guys have the autonomy in your community, you can solve it. This is the problem with side opposition's advocacy today. At the end of this debate, I'm still not convinced that side opposition actually ever solves any of the structural issues that we tell you are what are perpetuating these injustices. We aren't convinced how even the most wealthy communities or the person with the most capital is ever going to be able to combat structural imbalances that continually subject them to be viewed as less equal. Even if you have lots of money, you aren't ever going to have enough to be able to stand up to a racist state. We tell you that side opposition assumes that additional capital is necessarily going to solve for this, but at the end of the day, we're left wondering why, given that it's just simply not true that every single member of the African American community is impoverished, why we haven't seen bigger steps in society today. But we're also left wondering why necessarily they're going to get better public perception on their side of the house. We tell you what we need and what we're able to give you is a changing societal perception and a changing societal ideal of what our race relations are. On their side of the house, they continue to entrench differences, which are going to continue to subject the African American and minority communities to further racist societal policies, ideals, and biases. Recognize that people don't like unconditional aid. A really good example of this is in Maine, where just a couple election cycles ago, there was a ballot initiative where people pushed very strongly to restrict unconditional aid. We tell you that these types of public perceptions will be just as bad on their side of the house when it is viewed as just giving lump sums of reparations to these groups because of some historical past that people don't necessarily comprehend. On our side of the house, we are able to start a dialogue that where we talk about, like one of the questions asked, how to actually make sure that these programs are in fact useful and helpful in solving the problems by having the public hold the government more accountable, by looking at things like current data that says, look it, we're still facing massive differences in who is incarcerated and who is not incarcerated and who is facing police brutality. This is how you start the conversation, not by saying this is something that happened in the past and you can now handle it using your own capital. We tell you that, or we think that it is much more important that people are able to feel like the government is caring for them, that people are able to feel like they are one society that must work together to combat these biases. Not that it is two separate communities that are working in separate spheres, one that is worried about combating the racial problems within the United States, and the other that just does not care at all. We are happy to propose, as the side government, that we think targeted programs are the only way forward to continue solving the injustices that both sides of the House agree are so pernicious.
In this debate, you've heard two perspectives, a perspective on side opposition that gives you a new solution that provides you with an outlet by which we could solve for past harms, but that could help communities in their current conditions. On side government, again, what we hear from them is more of the same policies by which they have left a few questions unanswered. The first is, what was asked by a member of the audience. Well, what is different about these programs? The answer that we get is that they are targeted. There have been targeted programs that have been put in place since African Americans have been fighting for civil rights. We haven't gotten an answer as to what's different about that. I think that that was required for them to win this debate. But also, the fundamental question is, well, if you're gonna do these programs, they complain about how on our side of the house we don't solve structural inequality. But on their side of the house, how in fact do they get all of the things that we say that will happen when these reparations get put in place? African Americans being politically empowered, African Americans being able to invest in their own communities, African Americans having economic freedom, freedom that was not gained, was not given to them and had to have been taken. All of these things we say you get on side opposition, you haven't gotten there. Moving forward, I think that there are a few things that the questions in the audience got to, and I funneled them in to five different points. The first is better communities. We think that we get better communities on side opposition. Why is this the case? Because again, side government, and haven't gotten a response to this argument, embraces a utilitarian framework that practically marginalizes persons that are minorities. We say that this is the problem, haven't necessarily gotten a response to this, and we certainly say that we need to start investing in ideas that put minorities to the forefront. Somebody has to care about us. Secondly, we say that we prefer a better moral framework to governments, and they operate best, and we get better practical outcomes. Practical outcomes. Second, we think that with a greater political will given to African Americans, given that they are now having reparations and the ability to spend this money to fund their own candidates and campaigns, in the world where, yes, black mayors do exist, we prefer black mayors to have a base that has the ability to fund them and for African Americans to be able to expand their beliefs and expand their ideologies into markets that are dominated by the money of politics. On to structural imbalances. On both sides, structural imbalances do exist. But we raise the question, how in fact do you continue to trust the government and the state, as a member of the audience said, when time after time after time they have proven wrong and proven to privilege those that are in the majority? We fundamentally think that this is principally bad, and we certainly support reparations on our side of the house. Public perception. Ladies and gentlemen, they want to make this a big issue. They think this is a big argument for them. This is not an argument that they will win. Zoe tells you in her speech that if we use their methods, public perception says to people, hey, they're having this program to help minorities because statistics in this area are low. That says to the public that bad choices have led to this statistical representation of what's actually happening in these communities. We prefer on our side of the house that the issues that are dealt with in society are dealt with through the lens of what the state has historically done in the past to these individuals. We should not let the state continue to let its beliefs and its propose to the citizens that they should have a perception that it is their fault. We think that on our side of the house, we encourage a world that makes the state finally take responsibility for what it has let happen for many, many centuries. Finally, to address this point, putting a price tag on what is being done. First of all, we prefer that reparations be given no matter what price tag, as opposed to a world where they are not. We think that this is not as big of an issue as it comes out to be. We think that having a price tag or putting a price tag on a person's experiences is better than not having one at all, especially when we consider the fact that whatever price tag being put on this, whatever it may be, will be much less than what was taken from African Americans in their prosperity in the past. We certainly think that for all of these reasons, you should side with side opposition, because side government has given you what at best is insufficient. But even if sufficient, on balance, does not weigh to the sophistication that we give you on opposition. Thank you so much. It's been an honor.
I would like to thank everybody for coming out to the debate this afternoon, and I hope that the students who participated gave you some ground for thought and things that you want to think about. And there were a couple of comments from some audience members about the debate being polemic, and obviously it is. And the reason why we do that is it allows us to better understand how certain things function in isolation, but as the famed rhetorical scholar Kenneth Burke said, it's frequently not an either or, it is most often a both and. And so one of the things to think about as you leave is what of both sides of this debate can we bring forward into more of a comprehensive policy or strategic planning that would get some of the outcomes that both sides are advocating for and we all know that are desperately needed. There was one comment in the back about in this current political climate, how could we ever get this done? And I think that to speak to that, I think it's important to remember that there has never been a good political climate in which African Americans have fought and tried to earn the rights that they deserve. And what is necessary is not looking at the current political climate and being like, we can't do anything. What is necessary is to look at the political climate and say, now is the time that we must do something. Thank you again for coming out, and I would like to give a big round of applause to the debaters for participating and giving us a wonderful debate this afternoon.